Random House Audio presents Pilgrim's Wilderness, a true story of faith and madness on the Alaska frontier, by Tom Kizzia, read for you by Fred Sanders. As I walked through the wilderness of this world, I lighted on a certain place where was a den, and I laid me down in that place to sleep. And as I slept, I dreamed a dream. I dreamed, and behold, I saw a man clothed with rags, standing in a certain place, with his face from his own house, a book in his hand, and a great burden upon his back. John Bunyan, The Pilgrim's Progress, 1678. Author's Note. In the winter of 2002, a man with the wild gray beard of a biblical prophet showed up in the remote Alaska ghost town of McCarthy with his wife and 14 children. He called himself Papa Pilgrim. His family found a deserted mining camp in the mountains nearby, deep inside North America's largest national park, and set about building a homestead life straight out of the country's pioneer past. Pack horses, goat milk, bear meat, fiddles and guitars, and a Caterpillar D5 bulldozer. By the seventh month, the Pilgrim family did not use the pagan names of the calendar. They were at war with the National Park Service. I was a reporter for Alaska's biggest newspaper. Pilgrim was wary of reporters, bureaucrats, police officers, and park rangers. He said he would let me ride on horseback to the homestead to hear his story, in the company of his adult children, because my wife and I had a cabin of our own near McCarthy. The cabin had actually been my wife's idea. She had old ties to the small Wrangell Mountain community. For me, those mountains had mainly been a place to go camping, but Sally used to play the fiddle at dances in McCarthy's Tinder Dry hardware store and knew all the local characters and feuds. We were both East Coast refugees and had professional interests in the area as well. Sally, a Sierra Club lobbyist working to protect Alaska's still wild federal lands, and me, a former American Studies major, scribbling down stories of manifest destiny for the paper. After we met and married, we built a small cabin on her dream spot, a river bluff inside Wrangell St. Elias National Park and Preserve. Pilgrim seemed to believe this pioneering impulse would make me sympathetic to his struggles. He called me Neighbor Tom. Pilgrim's battle with the park appealed to Alaska's romantic notion of itself. His renunciation of modern life and fight against the advancing forces of government made him a hero to some. Pilgrim had the scapegrace appeal of a Western outlaw, but he presented himself above all as devoted to family and scripture, traits that squared him in the public eye and gave consequence both to his defiance of authority and to his pious engagement with his Lord's creation. His secrets were cloaked, as a state prosecutor later put it, under the guise of pursuing the Alaskan dream, of carving out a piece of the Alaska frontier, where a man pits his strength and that of his family against the wild. Such anachronistic strangeness might have been a red flag anywhere else, but it elicited great sympathy in McCarthy, where the arrival of federal agents in Park Service uniforms had only recently unsettled old habits of mind about independent self-sufficiency and dominion over nature. Papa Pilgrim said it seemed like God's plan that a McCarthy neighbor would arrive to tell his tale. It may be that in an empty wilderness, the individual stands out more, making it easier to believe an intervening deity would go to such trouble. Certainly, Pilgrim liked to tell his own story as a God-wrought tale of redemption. His turning points involved scenes of credulous wonder and signs from above. Let me propose, then, before passing to Pilgrim's story, such an opening scene in the pioneer life of Neighbor Tom. A late summer evening in the year we built our cabin in the Wrangells. I'm sitting with my bride on an open promontory above the canyon, Inspiration Point, Sally called it, in mock solemn National Park style. We listen to the river, and she rests her head on my shoulder as the moon comes up in a lazy northern trajectory, its yellow light peeking through a notch in the mountains, then vanishing behind the next summit, half appearing a second time and setting again, and finally floating free, a magical triple moonrise. Or so it seemed from where we sat. I realize now it was nothing more than the turning of the indifferent heavens. Prologue, Third Month. When the song of the snow machine had faded down the valley, the sisters got ready to go. Elishaba moved quickly through the morning cold and snow in heavy boots, insulated pants beneath her prairie skirt, ferrying provisions from the cabin, raisins, sleeping bags, two white sheets. Jerusalem and Hosanna tore through the tool shed looking for a spark plug. The plugs had been pulled from the old Skidoo Tundra machines that morning. It was late in the third month, and the days in Alaska were growing longer. The overcast was high, the temperature holding above zero. They knew they didn't have much time. White mountains squeezed the sky above the old mining cabin. For weeks, Elishaba had been looking up, praying as if to the summits. But she knew the snow was too deep. She would be tracked easily. The only trail, the one that had brought her family the attention they once shunned, ran 13 miles through the wilderness, slicing down the canyon through avalanche zones and back and forth across the frozen creek. The trail ended at a ghost town. McCarthy had once been a boomtown of bootleggers and prostitutes. These days, it was the only place in the Wrangell Mountains that could still be called a community, though most of the old buildings had fallen down and a mere handful of settlers remained through the silent winter. At first, that isolation had been the attraction. The Pilgrim family had traveled thousands of miles to reach the end of the road in Alaska. They had parked their trucks at the river and crossed a footbridge into town and continued on horseback and snow machine and bulldozer and foot to their new home. Now McCarthy burned in her imagination, not as the end of the road, but as a beginning. Psalms and Lamb and Abraham looked on in horror. Their big sisters had been put on silence. Yet here was Elishaba, calling out as she moved to and from the cabin, as if she no longer cared what would happen. Elishaba was the oldest of the 15 brothers and sisters, a pretty, dark-eyed, dark-haired young woman, strong from a lifetime of homestead chores, from wrangling horses and hunting game. At 29, she was no longer a girl, though she had never lived away from her family, never whispered secrets at a friend's house or flirted with a boy. She had been raised in isolation, sheltered from the world and its television and books, schooled only in survival and a dark exegesis of God's portents. She was the special daughter, chosen according to the Bible's solemn instruction. Her legal name was Butterfly Sunstar. She gave the children a brave and reassuring smile. They could see now that she was weeping and frightened, and that she did indeed still care. She was committing the unforgivable sin. The Lord had held her steadfast in these cold mountains and would not let her go. His grip was strong. Her sisters looked happy, though. Hosanna had found a spark plug. Perhaps it was a sign their enterprise was favored, after all. Jerusalem, short, blonde, and cherub-cheeked, at 16 the second oldest girl, had declared she would not let Elishaba go alone. Elishaba and Jerusalem said swift goodbyes and climbed together onto the little tundra and sped down the trail. They made it no farther than the open snow in the first muskeg swamp. The snow machine lurched to a stop. The fan belt had snapped. Jerusalem used a wrench to pull the spark plug and stumped back up the packed trail, post-holing through the snow. Elishaba tried to mend the belt with wire and pliers, but gave up. She looked about. The snow was too deep to flounder through, the trees too far away. It felt like one of those dreams where she tried to run and couldn't move. She sat listening for the sound of a snow machine returning up the valley from town. Instead, she heard Jerusalem coming on the other tundra. They reloaded their gear and started off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.